In this video, I'm going to be completing a frequency distribution table. Consider the data representing the price of laptop computers in dollars. So I have a data set here that's not put in order. There's 21 values, and I've already been given the lower class limits and the upper class limits. In other words, I've already been given the class limits for this problem. If I were to do this problem from scratch, I would probably choose the minimum value for the first lower class limit. That's one way to do this, or you could choose a value that's slightly smaller than the lowest value of the data set. All right, and then another thing that is asked for in a frequency distribution problem typically is the class width. And this is the common mistake I see from students. Given the class limits, students tend to want to subtract a lower class limit from its corresponding upper class limit, and that is not correct. To find the class width, you subtract either two consecutive lower class limits, or find the difference between two lower class limits, or the difference between two consecutive upper class limits. So I went ahead and found the class width by taking the second lower class limit and then subtracting the first lower class limit, and that is 60. So the class width is 60, and you could take two different consecutive lower class limits or upper class limits, and you would still get a class width of 60. Okay, now I want to find the frequency or the counts for of values for each class, and to do that you need to put the data set in order. And I've already inputted the data set into my calculator by using the edit screen. Now the data is not put in order. I need that to help me determine how many falls in each class. So to sort, I'm going to go back to my stat menu, select sort A for sort ascending, and then tell it the list where my data is. And then go back to stat and then edit, and you'll see that my data set is put in order. Now this part is a little cumbersome. Fortunately, this is a small data set of only 21 values. So I can just scroll down. My first data set, my first class goes from 1,116 up to 1,175. So just looking at how many values fall within that range, inclusive of those class limits, there's 4. Okay, and then scrolling down further, I figured this out before I started recording, just so you wouldn't have to painfully watch me try to count these. Okay, so one value in the second class, there were 5 values in the third class, 1 value in the fourth class, 2 values in the fifth class, 8 values in the sixth class. Now to double check to see if I got them all, if I summed all of these frequencies, I should get my sample size of 21. All right, so now on to class boundaries. Both class boundaries and midpoints are used if you wanted to create a corresponding histogram from this frequency distribution. So these two columns right here are for the histogram, which I'm not going to do in this video, but I'm just going to show you how to get those started. The class boundaries are created so that the bars of your histogram touch, which just makes it look supposedly nicer. I don't think it's that big of a deal. The biggest thing is that the bars are the same width. Okay, so that's why we have the class width to be constant for all of these classes. All right, so to find your lower class boundaries, all you do is subtract a half from your lower class boundaries, and for your lower class limits, and for your upper class boundaries, you add 0.5 to the upper class limits. So this first lower class boundary will be 1,115.5. Okay, so I just go half a unit down. And then for my upper class boundary, I want to add 0.5. Okay, so this next one will start at 1,175.5 and stop at 1,235.5. Okay, I'm running out of room here. So hopefully you get the point. This upper class boundary now becomes this lower class boundary. I'm already making mistakes. My apologies. 1, 2, 3, 5.5 up to 1,295.5. Okay, and so on. So pretty easy to fill out the rest of that column. I'm going to just leave that. I think you get the point. Now the midpoint is just the average of the lower class limit and the upper class limit for each class. So to find this first class midpoint, I'm going to take 1,116, add it to 1,175, and divide by 2. And I get a value of 1,145.5. Now, the midpoint, you can use midpoints in your histogram as tick marks and along the horizontal axis. And then the tick marks, if you were using midpoints, would be right in the center of the bar. I prefer to use midpoints, or you could go ahead and use class boundaries as the tick marks on your horizontal axis. It doesn't change the shape of the histogram at all. It just, it's just a preference. All right, now I could go ahead and do this similar calculation for each class, but I'm going to use the fact that all of these are equally spaced. So the midpoints would also be equally spaced. So to find the next midpoint, I'm just going to take 1,145.5 and add 60 to it to get 1,205.5, and then add 60 to that to get the next one, and so on. Okay, so that's how you would fill out that column. You could do this calculation for each one, that's perfectly fine. I just think it'd be a little bit quicker if you found the first midpoint and then added 60 as you keep going down. All right, now the relative frequency gives you in decimal form the percent of the values that fall in each class. Okay, so I know that there's 21 values. That's going to be my denominator for all of the values in this column. To find the relative frequency for the first class, I would take 4 and divide it by 21. For the second class, 1 divided by 21, and so on. Now, it's not that hard of a calculation, but I want to have my calculator do this for me. So in my second list, I'm going to put the frequencies. And then I'm going to just have the calculator do that division for me. I'm going to right arrow over to list 3, so that list 3, and up arrow, so that list 3 is highlighted. Press enter, it moves your cursor to the bottom of the screen. I'm going to tell it, for all the values in list 3, what I want you to do is take the values in list 2 and divide it by 21. So literally, I'm telling it, using my second key, here there's list 2, I'm telling it list 2 divided by 21. So it does the calculation for me, and then you can round to however many decimal places you want to round. I'm just going to go ahead and round to 2 decimal places. Okay, so filling that out. Just copying right from my calculator. I like the relative frequency column because it tells you in percent if I multiplied all of these by 100, what percent of the values fall in each class? Okay, I can easily see that this class here, the third class, has 24% of the values. The largest class is this last class with 38% of the values. If I added all of these frequencies, it should add to 1 or 100%. Now, I did a little rounding here, so it might not be exact, but if I left it all carried out to as many decimal places as shown in the calculator, it should add to 1. The cumulative frequency you can think of as a running total. Okay, so I'm going to start with the frequency for the first class, and then take this frequency, 4, and then add it to the next one. So that'll be 5. Okay, I'm creating a running total as I go down. So I'm going to take the 5 and then add it to the next frequency, and then keep doing that as I go down. And then 13 plus 8 is 21. Now it should be no surprise that the cumulative frequency for the last class is the same as the sample size.